So to begin, let's just start with a little bit of housekeeping. Once my system decides that yes, it wants to show a slideshow. And I expect this will take about an hour. Frankly, what decides that is how many questions you guys will ask. And there's another 15-minute optional at the end if you want to go over the data system. Speakers are myself, Kathy Jones, and Sarah Domney is looking after the technical end of things from Kitchener. Now, I believe between all of us, there's about 14, maybe 15 people attending, and that's great. I don't need a big group for this. I just want everybody to learn what they can. The bigger goal here is to put it online so that people can have access to the files later. What else can I share with you here? Sarah and I have found with most of these, adding a lot of options for questions doesn't help. So just please, we find the works best is the chat. So go ahead and enter your questions in the chat box. Or you can use Twitter with hashtag MMP survey, which I have not gotten up. So, Sarah, if you don't have it up, I will get that started. If you do have it up, that's terrific. So we are recording this. If the audio is clear, it will go be made available online at the Bird Studies Canada YouTube channel, probably by the end of the week. I have to take a couple days off this week, but I'm hoping to have this up and running at the end of the week. Now, let me see if I can move on forward. Just one quick question for everybody. Just wondering who out there actively is involved with citizen science programs other than the Marsh Monitoring Program, yes or no? Go ahead and put this in the chat window and we'll talk about it later. I think that's about it. Sarah, do you have anything to add before we get started?
Just to let everybody know, like you mentioned, we have about 12 people joining us, most of whom are from Ontario, but we do have a couple people joining us from Ohio as well.
That's good to hear. We have a very active group in Ohio, and it's terrific to see some of them have popped in for this talk. So let's move on forward and we'll get to the next part of it. So I mentioned a bit about citizen science, and Sarah and I asked you guys if you're involved with any citizen science. I'm sure some of you are. It's a big component of Bird Studies Canada activities. And if you're unfamiliar with Bird Studies Canada, I'm just going to put up this one slide. And I just want to tell you that we're not for profit, and our mission is to conserve wild birds of Canada through sound science, on the ground action, innovative partnerships, public engagement, and science-based advocacy. So we do a lot of citizen science programs, and programs like the Marsh Monitoring Program is included in that. It's one of our bigger ones, what we're discussing tonight. One more question to go out there. I'm going to ask a lot of questions, and Sarah has the unfortunate task of keeping track of them online, and because I'm just asking you to put them in the Twitter. So just a bit of a skill testing question. Which early bird goes pit in the spring? And probably go with the sound written out more so than my definition of it. Just put your answer in the chat and Sarah will tell us the results later. Now I'm going to keep us going here. So I am going to move on to the next question. This is basically a photo of the marsh because what we're talking about today is the Great Lakes Marsh Monitoring Bird Program, which there's a classic station. And to begin with, I'm going to just give you a quick overview a bit about the program and the overall protocol, going over it very quickly, and then we're going to get into the nitty-gritty. I just want to touch base on some of the more general stuff so that you have it in your mind as you're thinking through what we're talking about. So when you're looking at your wetland, this is a classic station. It's about a 100-meter radius focal point. You stand at the center and you look out and you survey. And that is used for birds, amphibians, and for habitat. Bird surveys vary generally. These occur in low wind, little rain, no, little wind, and not too cold. We're discovering that cold can be a little bit cooler than we previously thought, but you still don't want it to be extreme cold. It's a 15-minute survey at each station, and you visit each station once per visit, and it's 2 to 3 visits. Depending on your route, you can survey in the morning or the evening. I think a lot of people miss the fact that the broadcast is set up into 3 specific areas. You have a 5-minute passive listening period, and a 5-minute broadcast period, and a 5-minute passive listening period at the end. So as soon as you click on the button on your broadcast, it times it out, and when you hear the very last final beep, you've done the survey for that site. So I just wanted to mention again about the marsh itself and where you should be surveying. Many of you people are picking up existing routes. Some of you might have to build new routes, but also if you've been surveying the same route for a lot of years, you want to sit down and you want to make sure it still is an appropriate location. So a marsh is dominated by emergent non-woody plants. It has open water that has floating vegetation in it. There's few trees. We usually like to see less than 50% of the cover being trees and shrubs. The water can be standing or slow moving. Fast running water is not an example of a marsh. And it can be permanently or periodically flooded. So it's not unusual for some marshes to dry out during the season and flood again in the spring. Now, when you set up your stations and when you proof your stations and go back out to them, you also need to keep in mind things like the visibility. Can you see your station okay? Can you readily watch birds from where you're standing? Is it noisy? Does that impact your work? Is it safe? Is it easy to get into that station? And of course, time of day. Is this particular location going to be easier to survey because of noise and visibility and traffic in the morning or in the evening? That's a valid point, as well as what matches your schedule. We don't try to leave you out there alone. You all receive a participant's package. If your participant's package is getting a little old and worn out, you can request a new one. They're also available on the resources website, which we can discuss later. For birds, you need to have the Getting Started Manual and the Marsh Bird Manual and the Training CD. The Training CD cannot teach you your bird calls, but it's great at helping you refresh your memory and helping you with some of the more difficult tasks like comparing certain species, and we'll get into that later. There's, as I mentioned before, there is an online website as well. I strongly advise you to go on and find these resources in advance. Make sure you have everything you need for the season. I try not to be in the office all the time, and there's times that you need stuff that you can't get a hold of me. So having your secure website password set up and having your materials in advance and knowing you have everything you need is really in your best interest to make your survey that much more fun. All right, we mentioned this earlier in the original chat. What is your favorite bird? I know some people provided it. If you didn't, can you go ahead and give that now? And we will discuss it in a few minutes. And Sarah can tell us the results later. Sarah, no poll answers yet, but do we have anything we need to go over that people are asking about?
Nobody's asking any questions. I do actually have a couple poll answers if you would like me to answer them. As for the question, does anybody do any other citizen science? There was a pretty equal number of yeses and nos. And it seems like everybody has agreed that the early bird that goes peent is the American woodcock.
Okay, that sounds good. Then we'll move forward, and they're right, it is American woodcock, and that's actually one of my most favorite birds, but I'm a bad one. I'll look at a bird, and they're all my favorites, so I'm a hard one to pin down on that. There's at least one favorite in this slideshow, and I have lots of favorites, so I'm not a good one to ask who is your favorite bird. So we're not worrying so much about route establishment tonight, but I just wanted to go over the two most typical routes so that you guys have an idea what they look like. The one on the left is your classic large marsh route, where you have your bird stations every 250 meters apart, and every second bird station is an amphibian station. The other one is less classic and becoming more and more common all the time, and that's stations stuck on small marshes or patches of marshes through urban areas or in more inland sites where you don't have the big coastal marshes. And here you have to more strategically look at placing your stations to ensure you get best coverage. And it's not unusual as well that in urban centers you only get a single station to survey, and that's just because of the marsh that's left available in those sites. So here's another example of a marsh station. Now, there is minimum distances between stations for a reason. for birds is 250 meters. And the reason for that is we don't want to have duplicate calling of the broadcast between stations. And by putting the stations 250 meters apart, we can ensure that that call is not repeating itself after. That's also why you can't face two stations in one spot in opposite directions, because obviously, even though you're only looking at half a semicircle, the bird broadcast covers a whole 360 degrees. Now, finally, the station is supposed to be a 100 meter radius semicircle. How do you tell it's a 100 meter radius semicircle when you're in the bush or in the field? Very good question. Something we do recommend at times is that you flag out 50 meters or 50 yards, 55 yards, and 100 meters or 110 yards along the one side. And then you can use that to extrapolate how far out into the wetland 100 meters is. Another option is to walk it out or pace it out on land and just visually check at the beginning of each of your survey visits. Or for us Canadians, you can stop the car and click the trip meter to zero and then drive forward until it goes to 0.1 and look back. And that will give you an idea how big that distance is. So you have a visual concept of what you're estimating it at. Now, we're not going to, again, spend much time on the route contact form. This form needs to is sent with you every year. It needs to come back every year. And Section A needs to be completed. It's just your basic contact information if you plan to survey next year. Section B and C are all about the route. And if you say you have not changed any stations on the route, you're done with it. You don't have to go any farther. The rest of the stuff is if you change stations or if you're concerned and this information you have to share with me. And that should also come in with your date in the fall. Here's the back side of the page so you see where you put in the information on your route changes. So let's get a little bit more into the nitty-gritty about the bird surveys. Birds are surveyed 2 to 3 times per year. There is just enough time in the field season for 3 visits, so the 3rd visit is optional. Bird surveys should be a minimum of 10 days apart, and they are conducted between the 20th of May and the 5th of July. You should review the bird survey protocol before your survey, so this is just the basics. You should survey 30 minutes before sunrise until 10 a.m. or 4 hours before sunset or until dark. I should mention that that is already set on your route. Unless you're establishing a new route, it has been decided by earlier surveys if that is a morning route or an evening route, and you should stick with that timeline for the route. You need to have good visibility. Right now we're saying the temperature has to be greater than 16 degrees Celsius. That number is going to change. We are slowly working our way towards a protocol revision on this program. The last revision was, I think, 2003 now when it was last formally revised. When I say revising, it's more of a refreshing. We're taking all those old concepts like stakes and things like that out and just bringing it up to date. But we do have some recent analysis that shows us that you can readily detect these species far earlier than 16 degrees Celsius. So that number will be changing, we think. We could change our mind on that, but right now it looks that way. You want no precipitation. And you want little wind. High winds can not only decrease bird calling, it makes it more difficult to hear. It makes it more difficult to broadcast. And you're going to hear differently. Like you'll hear some birds from farther away if you're downwind, and other birds you'll hear less of if you're upwind. It's a 15-minute point count as well. Now, bird surveys do require far more skill than surveying frogs. So what I recommend is that you need to go out in the field and see if you can identify 50 common birds that you see in the marsh, what you see in the marsh, without picking up the field guide. If you find you have to pick up the field guide for your birds, you're going to find this survey too complicated. With that said, there's the odd bird that even I today will have to go and say, okay, I'm not sure what that is, and I may have to check later. So you'd write notes down on that, you check it later. That's fair. You'll find some strange bird in there that's not supposed to be there, and you'll have to track those as well. But just overall, you want to make sure you understand most of the birds you're going to see in your or you're going to find it too frustrating. Now, throughout this talk, I'm just going to give you an idea of what I see coming in as common errors, because by telling you now, it might help you prevent them later. I find one of the biggest problems that people have is they keep waiting for the right night. The right night never comes. Perfection does not happen in field work. Just go out on the first appropriate night within the field season that fits your schedule and get it done. Don't survey in inappropriate weather. I mentioned earlier about wind, but rain will also decrease calling as well. Well, they won't call. They won't be active. Another common problem we see before people even get into the survey when they're trying to set up the route is they're trying to choose a wetland or part of the wetland that has the great birds. Not really what we want. We're trying to get a standard picture across the wetlands of the Great Lakes Basin. So any wetland that matches the habitat we work with. And by setting your standard stations 250 meters apart or looking at more logistics like visibility and access when you set your stations, it makes for a better route. Speaking of which, when you place those stations, you don't have to think about visibility or logistics. Is that little shrub right in front of you going to grow so big that it's not going to allow you to see anymore? Something to consider. Are you down in a low area and the dike prevents you from being able to see well? We also don't want you reviewing last year's data before you go out because that may bias what you see. Try not to talk to each other while you're surveying. It's great to have somebody with you, but talking may decrease the bird calls and it may also distract you so much you miss a few species. Some of you, from what I saw in the names, have been surveying for a while, so feel free to add what you think are errors and share it in the chat box, and Sarah and I will talk about it later. All right, so now we're going to move into the first part of the protocol, and that's the focal bird species. One of the reasons that the marsh bird monitoring was developed because there's a core group of marsh species that are difficult to detect in many other survey techniques, which is why we bring in the broadcast. The broadcast encourages a territorial response from these species. The focal bird species are prioritized because they're difficult to find, but they're not the priority species. And we would like to hear about all the birds in the wetland. And when we do our analysis, we have a core set of, I think, about 15, 20 species we look at, including these particular species. So on the broadcast, you have least bittern, sora, Virginia rail, American coot, common moorhen, pied-billed green. It will also, you'll also get responses of American bittern, king rail, yellow rail, and black rail, depending on where you are, even though they are not on the focal bird species broadcast. Some people will say, but you want to track king rails. Oh, absolutely, you do. But they will respond to this, and our goal here is to get basic trends. If you want to specifically look for king rails or least bittern, you want to do those broadcasts alone and use a different survey technique. So, Sarah, do we have any questions so far?
No, we don't have any questions so far, but I can answer the last poll question, which was, what is your favorite marsh bird? A couple of people didn't have any favorites, which is pretty common considering there are so many, so that's not something to worry about. Some other options were red-winged blackbird, barn swallow. A lot of people really like herons and egrets, and common snipe.
Oh, they're all good. I'm not very particular with it. Of course, my favorite is still somewhat the American woodcock. You'll see my next favorite coming up shortly. I have a lot of favorites. So we'll move on to the next part, which is the focal species. So when you get to your survey site and you start playing your broadcast file, be it an MP3 file or the CD, you get 5 minutes of silence. And then you get a point where you have 30 seconds of calling of a species, 30 seconds of silence, 30 seconds of calling, and so forth until all the focal species call. And then you have another 5 minutes of silence afterwards, and that's the full length of the survey. So here we'll go across over the five species that are heard in the broadcast. Now, the first is the least bittern. We put that first because there is some belief that the smaller birds are less likely to respond after the large birds call. I should warn you that on this system, this is the loudest least bittern I have ever heard. When they're in the field, they're very, very quiet, and you have to work carefully to pick this up, especially if the marsh is busy. All right, now we're going to move on. The next species is a sora, which is one. It's not my favorite bird, but it's one of my favorite birds. And this is a great little bird, very loud, and if it's in the marsh, you will hear it, and here is its call. Now we'll move on and see what is next. I'm just making sure I have no comments that anybody can not hear the birds. It looks like everybody can hear the birds. So we'll move on to the next bird, which is the Virginia rail. And this is one of the two rails we list as focal species. The other one is king rail, and we don't play that. Their calls are similar, and this one has two calls that we play. When you look at the CD, there's a great section that compares Virginia rail to the king rail so that you can learn how to identify the differences in it. And that's a very, very good thing to learn. Quite likely none of you are going to hear a king rail this year, but last year was a big king rail and we had a lot of them on our records. So it all depends on the year. It's kind of important species to make sure you know just in case. But here's the Virginia rail. So that's a kicker call. And that's a whack-a-whack-a call. You only can stand so much of the whack-a-whack-a call. The next we have is a common moorhen and the American coot. These two we combine in the tape because their calls are so similar. The other thing is with these two species, if you're in a location where the ranges overlap, they are very difficult to tell. So it's perfectly good to list moot if you're not sure if you have a common moorhen or an American coot. I had the luxury of learning these species in an open wetland that they both occurred in. So I used to be pretty good at telling them apart. I'm gonna do my first bird survey here for in a couple of years this coming month. And it'll be interesting to see how well I do with these two species this summer. But here's the American coot, the common moorhen. All right, here's American coot. I think this guy sounds cacklier and more grumpy, but it all depends on what you get used to. Again, feel free to use the mute button if you are not certain which one you have. So next we have the final call on the broadcast, which is a pied billed grebe. And this is one of my most favorite birds for sure. I love the call. It's very long and very powerful, and you can hear it throughout the marsh. So you have to be careful counting it to make sure it's within your 100 meters or outside your 100 meters. The most fun thing about it is near the end of it, it sounds like it's gasping for breath before it starts to call again. Now we're moving over to some focal species that are not on the broadcast. American bittern is a highly likely one for all of you to get. It's a very common species that you actually never see, but it's there. The call is thumperlunk or thunder pumper are some of the names this bird has. It's a very loud, deep, rich call that carries over a lot of ground. So you have to be careful counting it again. You could very well hear it when it's 300-400 meters away. So you have to make sure you mark it right on your stations. I'll warn you that this particular call here is about the quietest American bittern call I've ever heard. And it looks like it didn't even register for you guys. So hopefully you got to hear it. If not, it is on the training CD. So go ahead and listen to the training CD. The king rail, as I mentioned before, this is another important species for you to know. It's unlikely that you will see it. I've had the pleasure of meeting up with two of these guys in my life. But the call is very rich, very deeper than the Virginia rail. And here, I'll let you listen to it here. Apparently, I don't have the second call for that. So another question for you, again, to put in the chat box. Have you heard focal species at your favorite marsh, or haven't you? Yes or no? This is kind of important to mention because we have done, I get a lot of emails every year saying, I'm not finding any focal species. My marsh can't be any good. The reality is they're not that common. These species, we figure in a good year, you make it two on a really nice marsh. I will often have stations that I'm skunked, and the odd marsh in my big coastal marshes that I'm skunked as well. Soras are a great one that come and visit in the marsh I survey in the spring, but that are gone when I want to do my actual broadcast surveys. So it's a fair question. Do you see focal species? Are you familiar with any of these? But don't expect to see them when you're on your survey. They just might not be there. Oh, here's a fun one. This, I think, is asking a lot of you guys, but we'll see how you can do it. These are all topics that are in the training CD. So what bird says kir, and what bird says cur? And these are related birds. Which of these two birds is more prevalent when you survey? What similar species may you hear at your marsh, and at what time of day? And also, who is their louder cousin? Go ahead and put the answer in the chat. We're going to go over this quite a bit later, and I'll bring it up again, but I just thought I'd mention it. Don't be surprised if you don't get the answer. This is a pretty difficult question, so I'll go over it again. What bird says cure, and what bird says cure? Which is more prevalent where you survey? What similar species may you hear at your marsh, and who is their louder cousin? And we'll go over those answers later. So let's move on. So now a bit of troubleshooting on the species ID, just so that you guys know. When you're listening, try to catch the full calls. They don't always give them, fair enough, but try to catch the full calls when you hear them. And know which species are in your region. Like, there's going to be calls on the training CD and in your field guides that you're just not going to see, and be aware of that. Like, are you in the region for the American coot or the common moorhead? Are you likely to see a sedge wren or a marsh wren? This is an important thing to know. Know any unusual calls that they make, like the kicker call versus the wacka wacka call for the Virginia rail. Know what species might sound similar. Again, the MMPCD is great for those comparisons. There's several paired comparisons of species that are quite similar. And know the similar looking species as well. The biggest problem I think people make is they try to survey birds before they are ready. It is difficult. So take your time and practice. If you can, if just have to do amphibians for the first little while, that's absolutely fine. And start surveying birds when you're comfortable with it. Now, if any of you, especially those who have been with the survey for a while, know of a great challenge for identifying marsh birds that you're aware of, let us know if any of the newbies have a certain question about what might make it a challenge for identifying these birds, go ahead and add that as well, and we'll come back to it later. Now, as I mentioned earlier, we don't just look at focal bird species. We have a suite of species we use to identify marsh quality. And there's three ways we collect information on other species. We look at mapped observations. These are birds physically using that station area. Aerial foragers. These are actively foraging above the station. Often they're erratic, moving around, picking up bugs a bit slower. And then there's the fly-throughs, which zip through the station. And with them are the outside birds that are just sitting outside of the station. And those are all things that we collect as well. So let's start by taking a quick look at how you fill out the form. Now the form is split up into different sections. At the beginning, you have the visit information. You put that in as soon as you get to the station. Then you have the focal species table, and you have the secondary species table. So those three areas that you see highlighted right now are what you use in the field. Later, when you get back to the car, and Suitor is always better with this, you can complete the secondary species summary, which we'll go over at the bottom in a few minutes. So let's pretend we're doing a survey. And by the way, there's a great example in the book, so go ahead and look in the book and review the sample. I think there's an error in it. I keep telling people that, thinking who's going to find that error unless I actually correct it in the last version. And so feel free to let me know if you find that error. So let's start off, and you walk into your station. And what happens first? Well, the least bidder, two of them are there when you arrive. So you mark each of those least bidders separately on the form by saying before and after the survey. And the first one was within 100 meters, and the second one wasn't. And you mark that down. And then you start your broadcast tape. And you start with the passive listening, which is 5 minutes of quiet. And during that time, the Pied Bill Grebe is calling, and you mark him down. He was calling in minute one and minute two. And you keep listening, and you keep looking, and you're seeing what's out there and what's around. And the next thing you hear, right near the end of that passive listening period, American Bittern. Now, it's calling very far away, so you don't mark it as within 100 meters. Focal species, you always count all the focal species you hear, but you let us know if they're within 100 meters or outside. And you keep listening. And what do you see next? Well, actually, it was in the first 5 minutes, you saw a single lonely tree swallow following around looking for insects, so you mark him down. You keep looking, you keep listening. And there's a single swamp sparrow calling as well. And you put a one beside that to mark the fact that he's calling in the first 5 minutes. Your 5 minutes is not done. And just before the end of the 5 minutes, you notice two red-winged blackbird males calling. And you mark them down. And you again put a one there to identify that they're calling in the first 5 minute period. And the next thing you know, the broadcast starts for least bittern. And funny enough, when the least bittern broadcast starts, you hear a Virginia rail. So you mark that Virginia rail down. And you say, it's pretty close, it's within 100 meters, and you mark that as well. And you keep listening and you keep counting. Tree swallows, you have three, you actually have four flying around during the second 5 minutes. So how many new ones do you have? You know you originally have one, you have no idea if that first tree swallow is still there. You assume it is, and you mark down three because you're absolutely certain you have at least three more. And you keep listening. And you hear another red-winged blackbird, and you mark it down, and you put a two beside it because it's calling in the second five-minute period. You keep looking, you keep listening. Where am I now? Oh, there we are. And we're moving into our third five-minute period. And suddenly you have 14 tree swallows. So how many are new? You don't know. You assume that the four that you originally have are still there, and you mark down 10. You also have a single barn swallow calling, and you mark it down as well. And now, if things are quieting down, you're pretty certain you know where all your focal species are, but you keep listening and you keep looking. Black tern flies through, it just zips right through, so you mark him down as an outside fly through. You keep looking and listening. And a mallard lands as well, or flies through, so you mark down that mallard. Next thing you know, you're scanning all through the back of your 100 meter radius, and lo and behold, you've missed it this whole time. There's a Canada goose on a nest back there. So you mark it down, and you add a three for being detected for the very first time in the last 5 minute period. Also, a mallard flies in. When that mallard flies in, you mark it down. You mark down that you heard it in the last 5 minute period, and then you scratch it out as an outside fly through because it's more important that the mallard has landed on the wetland itself. As you keep listening, three wood ducks fly out of the back and leave. So you mark those down. I should say one wood duck in a survey period five. You also have a common yellow throat that flies in and out. And there was two earlier common yellow throats in a pair with chicks that you had marked down on visit two as well. Then finally, just before the end of the survey, you hear two American woodcocks, and they are within 100 meters. And they actually, after the survey, you also notice that there is sandhill cranes calling, and those American woodcocks had five young as well, or the American coots. So that's all done, and you go down and you finish your survey, you get all your survey stations done, and then you sit down in the car at home, you pour yourself a cold or a warm drink, and you start recording the species. Now, how does this work? So to begin with, what I try to do, you have to go back at it in some kind of a standard format. So I go back at it by detectability periods. And I always start with my little graph here. I say, what did I hear in the first couple minutes? I heard in the first 5 minute period, two red-winged blackbirds. So I put those down. Did I hear any more red-winged blackbirds? Yes, one. So I mark it down. What's next? What else did I hear in that first 5 minute period? Well, there was a single swamp sparrow, and I mark him down. There was also that tree swallow, and I mark them down just as I recorded them in my tally, that I had one in my first 5 minutes, three new ones in my second 5 minutes, and 10 new ones in my third. And you keep listening and going on. You know that there was a black tern that flew through, and you mark that down as well. And then the other species you saw in the last 5 minutes, the mallard, the Canada goose, the wood duck, and the barn swallow, you mark those down. Then finally, you have those common yellow throats. There was two in a pair in the first, in the second 5 minutes, and a third in the third 5 minutes. And that's it. Feel free to ask questions about this later. I know it gets complicated. So now I'm going to just go over some more extended examples of what you have to do with each of those areas. First off, that's a lot to keep track of, absolutely. But 15 minutes is a long time when you're surveying a species, a system like this. So you have enough time, without a doubt. Try and prioritize, though. We recommend putting the focal species first. Once you're confident that in that last swing around looking for everything in the marsh, you go on to do your map species, then your aerial foragers, and then your outside fly through. And you just keep cycling back to that thing. If you have to spend more time counting focal species because they're there and you have to ignore outside fly throughs and aerial foragers, so be it. But usually you have time, especially in the last 5 minutes, to pick everything up. Now, for your second focal species, you'll notice that each bird gets a separate line. We also show each period that you detect them in. And we'd say whether you heard them within 100 meters or outside 100 meters. The little direction box, we can't scan that in. This is just for your convenience. If you're concerned about keeping track of too many birds, you can use these to plunk a little dot in to say which direction, like this bird was on the east, this bird was on the west, and so forth, just to help you keep track. We don't put young in, and if they call after the period, we don't mention that either, other than just as a comment. Now, for the little map that we have there for you to put your mapped observations in, that's for birds that are actively using the station. Some points, you notice I have a certain pattern of coding there. That is in your forms. You have a page that has bird ID codes on it and some sketches and stuff about symbols that you can use. Go ahead and use those. If you use a different coding technique for a different survey, feel free. I'm pretty good at figuring them out. The other thing that you'll notice that there's a subscript, 1, 2, and 3. We need a mechanism to do two things. One, we have to know how many birds you saw. Two, we need to know what detectability period they're in, whether it's the first 5 minutes, the second 5 minutes, or the third. And in my example here, I'm using the ones and the two and the threes to represent those 5 minute periods. Now, a couple of the points, we only want breeding adults, ignore all the young. I know sometimes that can be difficult, but try to. We only count male blackbirds, that's red-winged blackbirds and yellow-headed blackbirds. The reason being, for colonial species, it's just too hard to count the females and they don't stand out. Now, also remember that distances change. For your focal species, it's unlimited distance. Any focal species you see in front of you, you write down, you just track whether it's within 100 meters or out. For your map species, and your aerial foragers, you want to record whether they're within only the species that are within 100 meters. If they're outside of the 100 meters, you don't tell them about it. What else is there? When you count aerial foragers, don't put down the maximum count you see. Put down the maximum number of new ones you see in each detectability period. So you have that one bird you saw in the first 5 minutes. You had four in total in the second 5 minutes. You assume the first bird was still there. So you got three new ones. You have 14 in total at the end of the survey. You assume those four earlier ones are still there, and you write down the 14. You don't have to count outside fly-throughs. Granted, it does not make a big difference at this point if you do. It's just using your time that you can be using it for something else. You just mark them down. And absence, presence, that's all we can do with this information. So if that mallard moves over here, you can ignore it at this point. You can mark it off. Now, what else do we have here? I think we covered everything, and we covered this part as well. Yep, we're good with that. We're going to move on to the next section, and you guys can ask any question you want later.
Hey, Kathy, we do have a question already.
Oh, do you want me to take a stop and ask some questions? All right, go ahead.
We just have one question relating to that survey, if you want to go back to that last slide.
This one?
Yes. So in terms of the secondary species, it's possible you went over this, but do you need to specify if you detect secondary species by sight and or sound? And if you do, how would you go about doing that?
You do, yet you don't. It's not relevant to me as long as you're confident in your ID. I'm assuming that you know how to identify it. So when the data comes in, I don't differentiate the quality of the information based on sight or sound. Now, in these situations, what you're seeing here, if it's just a dot in this particular coding system, it means sight. And if there's a circle around it, it means calling. If it's a little asterisk, it means it's on a nest. And if it's a little house, it's a family. So you're seeing all of them. So I automatically identify them that way on this form. But when you summarize it, you don't. You just put it in, and I trust that if you heard it or you see it, you knew what you were doing and that you have the ID right. Any other questions, Sarah?
No other questions, but if it's a good time, I can go over the last polls that you provided.
Sure, because I'm sure I've put people in the information overload by now. Go ahead.
All right, so we did actually have a couple people who have seen focal species on their routes. Most people haven't yet, but we do have some that have, so that's great. In terms of that question you put, the bunch of questions, like which species says cur, which one says kir, which one is more prevalent, we actually didn't get any answers to that those questions, so that might be a fun thing for you to go over.
We will go over it at the end. I was expecting problems with that one. It's a very tough thing to work on. And once I'm done, you're going to say, is she right? And it's not, it's completely fair to go and pull out the field guides with this one and look them up and listen to the CD. But the answers are actually on the CD to a certain extent. And decide for your own region, because it also may be different depending on the region you're in. So we'll go over that after we get the other stuff done. So some common data form errors, this one I'm going to go over quickly. We only have about 23 minutes yet, so we're tight for time. Now, it's one row for each individual focal species. So keep that in mind. The tallying of the aerial foragers is needed. Don't just put down the species, because then that doesn't help. You don't have to count the outside fly-throughs, as I mentioned before. That's not necessary. If you do it, it's not a big deal, but you don't have to. A really unusual problem, I think people get confused with this. So what they do is they'll say, oh, I have like a black tern here and a black tern here. So I have to list black tern twice. Once as an outside fly through, once as a mapped species. And you really don't. You just mention it once and you summarize the whole thing together. A question for the people who are online. Is there anyone who has not done a habitat survey form or has not watched or was part of the first webinar? Because if that's the case and everybody's seen habitat stuff, I'm gonna go right through it and into the little field test that we have afterwards, because we only have about 20 minutes left. So just a question for everybody. Now to move on, what's next here? Well, yep. One row for individual. You have to count your aerial foragers and you just write down your outside fly-throughs. And one row per species in your secondary summary. Other things, it's not totally abnormal for people to sit there and say, this species is important and this species isn't. That's fine, but tell me about everything you see. We have a set guild of species we look at, and other people come for us for data that they know that they often see in a wetland. So tell us about everything you see. Don't add that other complex need to identify which species is good and bad while you're surveying. Careful about recording species outside the breeding range and in unusual places. If I think it's a weird thing to say, I will be in contact with you with an email saying, are you sure? And maybe you are. Maybe you did see that species. But be aware of the fact that some species are unusual. Let me know about the weather conditions. If I don't know the weather, that data may not be used in some analysis. Misidentifying stations. It's quite easy to say the station I'm surveying today is A and the next one's B. But all the data anymore is coded to a particular location, a particular dot on the world map that we identified that is this station. So Route 294A is always that same location, 294A. 294B is always B. So you don't want to get those out of order. You can survey out of order as long as you identify them right on your forms. Putting data from two routes on the same summary data sheet. That's fairly minor with the bird surveys because the way the data is entered, it works. But ideally, we would like to have Route 294 on one set of sheets and 295 on another set of sheets, even though they're both two station routes. We need you to tell us where you are, like what route you're surveying, and who you are, what your name is, or your route ID. There's a lot of these forms come back in. My biggest nightmare is the wind's going to come and blow them all and mix them up, and they're not going to be the codes on them that we need. So make sure you add those identifiers. We need you to provide habitat data annually. That's very important. It helps me quality check the data, and it helps us identify stations that we need to remove from the system. Plus, we do habitat association work with this data, so we want that information annually. And that route contact form that I've already mentioned, it's great to get that as well. Do we have any questions, Sarah, before I move on to the next thing, or any comments?
We did have one comment about the circles around the species on the data forms. Uh-huh. If you want to go over, I'm not sure if that's a personal preference just to circle the species, but someone was wondering what the circles represent.
Okay, let me just go back here on this form here. This is part of the way the atlases, if anybody's done a breeding bird atlas, this is part of their system that they originally set up when they started doing bird surveys or forest bird monitoring. Every system has an array of identifying seen birds versus calling birds and things like that. If you look at the sheet that comes into your data set that has all the bird codes on it, if you flip it over, it has some options for this. We don't get carried away with this. I'm pretty good at picking out all the different ways people symbolize birds in the system. And once I got it figured out, I can go with it. But in this particular system that I'm using here, a dot means seen, it's just a bird seen. Circled means it's calling. In this situation here with the two lines, it means it's two birds calling. And this yellow throat has moved. And here's another common yellow throat here. So circle is calling, a dot is not calling. It's seen, an asterisk is a nest, and the cute little house is a family pair. But if you have the own system that you work with, as long as you're consistent, that's great. Just remember to give me the detectability times, because you're going to need that when you do the secondary summary. So you want to have separation between the first 5 minutes, the second 5 minutes, and the third, so that you can fill out this correctly. Any other questions, Sarah?
Nope, that's all the questions for now.
All right. Did we have anybody who needed me to go over habitat?
Yes, we did have somebody who has not done a habitat form yet.
Okay, we'll go over this quickly. We have enough time. Habitat's quite important. It's done once a year. It's not a lot of work. It should take you, 1 to 2 minutes per station here. To be fair, it may take up to 5. The first year, it's going to take more time as you get used to it. It's best done between late May and mid-June. You have to be careful when you schedule your habitat. It seems like something you leave till the end, whatever. It's just collecting habitat. But it doesn't work that way. You have to have the vegetation flushed up enough that you can tell what it is. But you have to have that cactus low enough so that you can see over it. Like if you see this picture of Tara here with her binoculars, if she had to see over those cactus, she'd have a really hard time. And anybody who's vertically challenged will have a hard time. So you want to make sure you do your habitat before the cactus get too big and the Phragmites gets too tall. So for bird surveyors, I recommend around the first visit. You guys have a bit of a luxury. I'm really encouraging you to take a friend with you. Have them do the habitat for you. For frog surveyors, they have no choice. They have to go out another time during the day, and it's usually best around the second visit. This year might be later. This year, the second visit, I think, is going to be so cool enough with the way the system's going that the frog surveyors might have to be a little later. And basically, you stand at the focal point and you estimate the coverage. I like to put a little drawing at the bottom, and that just clarifies for me what all is in my station and makes it easy to do the rest of the survey. And this again is explained in the protocol, the getting started protocol, quite well. The first thing is a percent major habitat. So you're looking here, if you take your whole 100 meter radius sampling area and you look at it and you say, how much of these different things do I have? How much of this 100% area is emergent vegetation? How much of it is large patches of floating water, mud, or trees, or shrubs? I should mention on the back of this form is your definitions, so you're not walking out in the field without those definitions with you, which makes it easier. A should always add up to 100 because you're looking at the entire area and what it encompasses. B through F are just questions about the overall habitat. Most of these can be answered in the field. The ones such as overall marsh size, might know that. You might have to look it up. It's pretty easy to guess based on the definitions in the back. I wouldn't worry about going and looking it up somewhere. Just do your best to estimate. Same with wetland permanency. If you see things like water controls in there and it's a big marsh, it's pretty safe to say it's permanent. Perhaps so, if you might put down semi-permanent and decide at the end of the season, no, this is seasonal because it's out of water now, so it's okay to change that answer later. And finally, we have dominant emergent vegetation. And I think this is the one that throws people. Dominant emergent vegetation is emergent vegetation, so the stuff that stands out of the water, not trees and not shrubs. And we don't expect you to know everything. We're looking at more with style of plant type. So here, for example, in this station, we have the 4 dominant species, and you want to give the top 4. There might not always be 4. There might be 2, there might be 1. But in this situation, there's 4. And we say it's cactail, grasses and grass-like sedges, rushes and bulrushes, and pickerel weed. So already you see we're not getting into a lot of detail there. And to be a dominant species, you have to have at least 10% cover. So if you're saying you take that 100 meter area and you look around and you just now look at the vegetation, you say, okay, of the emergent vegetation, all of it put together, I think 50% of it is cactail, and you write it down. Boy, I think the next biggest thing is grasses and shrubs, grasses and grass-like sedges, things like that. I think I got about 20%. I also have about 10% rushes and 10% pickerel. You might see some wild rice. You might see some other stuff, some like reeds, but because they're all less than 10%, you don't record them. Now, when you add those up, they come to what? 90. Hold it, that's not 100. It doesn't have to be 100. You can have dominant emergent vegetation species and a whole bunch of little things. So it's quite common that this doesn't add up to 100. But you also might have a cactail monoculture. So you have cactails at 80 or 90%, or maybe just 2 species involved. So don't be surprised if you don't have 4 species listed either. And that's it for habitat. Quickly going over data, limit the paperwork, use your field forms in the field, not the field books. Don't forget who you are, provide the route and volunteer identifiers. Photocopy and keep a form where you are. There's always at least one data set that is lost in the mail for some reason, and it's heartbreaking. So make a point of keeping a copy at home so that if I'm the one who calls you and you say, Well, I sent it already, and I said, if it didn't get here, you could send me a scan of the originals. Send the originals to us. At this time, the data entry system is down and will remain down this year. We're refreshing the OWL survey data entry system this year. MMP is on hold until that's done. We didn't like the way it was running. But in the future, if you enter your data online, we might want you to email a copy of the data for the first year or so, just so that we can cross-reference it and make sure everything's good. So that's it. Safety, just stay safe. If you doubt the conditions, don't survey. Don't survey in storms. Is the site accessible? Does it have a reputation that you want to avoid? Take your safety gear with you. Be more careful with road routes and boat routes. Just make sure you're always safe on the site. That decision I have to leave up to you guys because I'm not there. I can only give you some advice. And this is my friend John, who I used to work with. And I put him up because we used to use this all the time. It's a great fun photo of somebody calling until I got a complaint. And so I'm going to ask you the same thing that was informed to me. What is wrong with this picture? So we're going to use John here as a teaching tool. First up, he's standing up in the boat. We all know we shouldn't stand up in boats. He has no life jacket on. It's beside him, but he has no life jacket on. More of a logistics thing. How does he use his binoculars? Now, granted, in this situation, somebody's taken his photo, but the broadcast unit should really be with his partner who's in the front of the boat taking the photo. A couple reasons being, and a really good one is, John can't hear as well when he's holding that broadcast unit. So by giving the broadcast unit to his friend and colleague, he can hear his birds better. He can use his binoculars better. He can write down his data better, and it just works for a better system. Does this boat need a light? I don't see one on this boat. To be fair, when you're doing night evening bird surveys, you could end up out there very close to dark, or if you get in trouble after dark. So consider that. What are the navigational needs for your area to keep yourself safe? Where's his hat? Where's his bug shirt? Things like that. Those are other things that you may want to keep in mind. Sun conditions are becoming more serious. You just don't want to take risks anymore. Enjoy yourself while you're surveying, but stay safe. Now, if you have any other safety concerns that you feel that everybody should be aware of, add them to the chat box. A good one, for example, is I had a volunteer in Sault Ste. Marie went out and checked out the site last week, which now he says has about 3/4 of a yard of snow in it. And he looked over to his right and he said, oh, there's an active bear den. Oh, that was what I'm hearing when I'm surveying. Maybe I better find a different location to do my amphibian survey. And I'm thinking, you know what, he's probably right. Why take risks with something like that, that close to an animal's territory at night? It's just not worth it. He can go and find another spot to do his amphibian survey than right beside the bear den. Things like that can make a difference. Any more questions and answers, Sarah, before I move on to the next item?
Nope, there are no more questions here.
Okay. So what about that skill tester that nobody got? It's a hard one. This is on the CD, so go ahead and listen to it. What bird says kir and what bird says cur? I have to listen to the CD over and over again to get this. And what we're talking about here is common tern versus forester's tern. Now, which is more prevalent in your area? It's hard to say. Common tern in general is more common, but in some areas, including mine, you might get more forester's tern. So it's a good information to look a little bit deeper in your area and find out. So what similar species may you hear at your marsh and at what time of day? And what is the louder cousins? Now that I mentioned terns, you probably have the louder cousins here. But we'll go over here. So to give you an example, if you pull out your bird ID card, I have this problem because I have both species nearby. Every year trying to misidentify the species. Birdathon, they always drive me nuts. Now, a common tern has a black elbow and underring. It's got black on the outermost tail feathers, and the top of the wing is black tipped. A forester's tern has an eye cheek patch. They have very white wings, especially at the upper tip. So common is black tips. Forester's has white tips. Common is cur. Forster's is cur. Now, the really loud one is their cousin. We'll call him cousin for now. Caspian tern, which is considerably bigger. He's got that big, big, big orange bill, and he's got a very raucous call. Another noisy little guy is this black tern, and they're very territorial. You'll know when you have those on your survey site because they will complain about you being there. So that's the kind of more complicated identification that you need to get into at times, depending on the wetland you're at. And there's good information in the training CD about that. So that's it. Now, I remember everybody, I suggested that you need a pencil or a pen. We have a little quiz here. Before I walk into the quiz, do we have any questions, Sarah? And that'll give people time to get organized.
No, we do not have any questions yet.
All right, then we're going to do a little wee station survey here. We have this lovely wetland, I would say that's Big Creek National Wildlife Area by the looks of it, and we're standing at our focus point. And this will be the quickest 15 minutes you've ever experienced. So during your survey, the first thing you hear is a pied-billed grebe. It is about 75 meters away, and it calls during minute 3, 4, 9, 10, and 14, 15. So in your mind or on your sheet of paper or on your field form, write down how you think you'd record that on the form. I don't know how long you guys take to do this, so we're going to move on. And if you need more time, just shout out in the chat, need more time. So the next you see flying around in the station during the survey, you see a barn swallow. And it's feeding during minute 1 and 2. Later on, another barn swallow joins him in minutes 11, 12, doing the same thing. And how do you write that down on your forms? Can you try to do that? Okay, I'm going to just give you a few more seconds here. This is not a busy site, so you'll have no problem doing this. All right, moving on. You also hear a red-winged blackbird male calling, and you detect it for the first time in minute 1 to 2. Very quiet wetland, nothing else calls, but another red-winged blackbird male starts calling in minute 8, 9. So go ahead and write that one down. All right. So finally, in the last 5 minutes, a great blue heron flies over during the last 5 minutes of the survey. So you need to write that down as well. Now, I have no idea whether you guys managed to get this onto paper and stuff, but I'm going to, unless you have some specific questions about this, I'm going to go right into showing you how it looks on the form. Sarah, do we have any questions before we go on?
No questions here. I think everyone's ready for the answers.
Okay. So here's your form. So the pied-billed grebe is a focal species. So it goes at the top of the form. And we heard it during the minutes 3 and 4, 9 and 10, 10, 15. Here we put the direction this bird was facing. And it was within 100 meters because it was 75 meters away. And there you go. Now the next one was the barn swallow. And you'll notice here that my coding for barn swallow here is different from the coding earlier by Doug for barn swallow. So all I suggest is that you look at the code on your yellow forms and decide what we're supposed to be using for barn swallow. And make sure you know the difference between barn swallow and mega swallow. So he was feeding us in, one was foraging during minute first 5 minutes, and the second one joined in the third 5 minutes. So you now have two birds marked in those 2 5-minute periods. So we also had coming through here a great blue heron just kind of zipped through and went on. So you mark that as an outside fly through. And then we also have one red-winged blackbird heard in minute 1 and 2, so it's in the first 5 minutes. Another red-winged blackbird heard in minute 8, 9, which is the second set of 5 minutes. So that's it. That's what we got on the station. How do we summarize it? The red-winged blackbirds, we got two of them, and we marked down red-winged blackbird, one in the first 5 minutes, the second of the second 5 minutes. Remember that each species for your secondary survey, you only recorded the first 5 minutes they detected. Barn swallow, the first one was detected in the first 5 minutes. The second one was detected in the last 5 minutes. Great blue heron, it was just an outside fly through, so we just pull in the circle here. We don't mark them down as being on the station. I think that's everything. It is. So that's it. That's pretty much all. And we're actually 1 minute from being an hour and 3 minutes. Do we have any questions or anything people want to go over? Go ahead and add them. Anything at all that people want to talk about? If anybody wants me to go over the online data system, I'm happy to do that next as well if people are interested. But I thought I'd open it up, Sarah, and see if anybody has any questions.
I'm not seeing any questions coming into the chat. Do you think we should just unmute everybody?
Well, there's 16 of us. Yeah, sure. If anybody wants to say something, they can go ahead and ask. They can let us know as well if they'd like to go over the data entry. Okay. So what do you guys think? Is there anything in particular that you want to talk about? I think Sarah's going to unmute you, or you can add it to the chat box. And while you guys are thinking about that, I'll just move on and just say that thank you for attending. It's important that you all come, and I'm glad you took the time to listen in. Still working on questions. Reminding everybody that we have lots of training materials that you can look at, including the CDs and the Habitat Veg Guide that you get your first year. What else do we have to share? And there's also lots of online resources. So does anyone have any questions out there? Okay, well, I guess that's it then. Sarah, do you have anything else to add?
Nope, no questions here.
All right, well, then I will say goodbye to everyone, and you all have a great evening. Thank you so much for joining me, and we'll talk to you soon. Okay, take care, everyone.